Welcome back to Old School Sports and our Out of the Park Baseball 24 playthrough of the Buffalo Wings. And we are at the first day of summer in 2046, and the Wings are having an excellent season as we pursue a potential three-peat this year. 50-32 record, the best record in baseball. You can see most of our players are among the tops in all of baseball at their positions. We've got a good crew of prospects down in the minor leagues this year. And despite some injuries, the season has gone very well so far by virtue of having won the World Series last year with the best record in baseball and also a number of compensatory picks. We're about to make our first pick in this year's draft, which is the final first-round pick, 40th overall. So not going to be an incredible pool of talent to pick from. We reviewed some of the top prospects available at the end of our last episode. Appreciate the thoughts on which direction to go, shared by YME943. Always helpful to get feedback from trusted viewers on which direction to go. I think I do agree with YME943 as far as the position player that I like the best. As I mentioned at the end of last episode, I was very intrigued by Tony Van Horn's potential, the speed, interesting bat that could generate a ton of extra base hits and hit for a pretty high average, good range in the outfield. But some of those personality traits do scare me as far as him making the most of his development. And one thing that I hadn't noticed when I did my initial review in the last episode was that Amari Hankton, center fielder, who is a decent hitting prospect, decent glove, probably more of a right fielder than a center fielder, also is a potential two-way guy. Not an incredible pitching profile, 50 potential stuff, 50 potential movement, 60 potential control. Does have solid stamina and is solid at holding on runners. Only a two-pitch arsenal, though. Throws in the low to mid-90s. So best case scenario, he's probably a long reliever, maybe a middle reliever out of the bullpen if things go very well for him. But combined with a guy who looks like he could have a competent major league bat, is not the worst prospect in the world. I still don't think he's got the upside that I normally look for, particularly in the first round, and that has drawn me back to the starting pitcher, Mike Chapman. Really good stamina, acceptable at holding on runners, certainly could be better. Just turned 18 very recently, throws in the low to mid-90s. But if that curveball develops, he likely has a very impressive four-pitch arsenal. Excellent stuff. Movement and control, both certainly a question. But I still think that Chapman, at his best, is probably a really good second or third starter. While honestly, to me, Hankton, at his best, is a fourth outfielder who also can help in the bullpen. And although that certainly has some value, I am going to go with the pitcher that I think has a little more upside, Mike Chapman. We've been pretty good at developing pitchers throughout this playthrough, and I tend to usually take one in the first round, quite honestly. A lot of years we've had multiple first round picks because of compensatory picks that we have received when we've lost free agents. But certainly I think if you were to look back on, I think this is the 24th draft we've done in this playthrough, I would have to guess that we've probably taken pitchers in the first round in two-thirds of those 24 drafts. So you could argue that I don't need to take more pitchers because the pitching in our organization in both the minors and particularly in the majors right now is really strong. But we have depleted it a lot with some of the trades we've made in recent years, bringing on the likes of Fuchs and Jim Reichert, Weisenbach, the other shortstop that we've brought on, as well as some other trades we've made in earlier years to bring on more major league ready talent. We've definitely depleted some of the depth in our organization from all those early drafts. And as I said, I just think Chapman's got a higher ceiling, which is generally what I'm looking for in the first round. I'm going to take him, but we'll see what our scouting director recommends. He recommends Gene Marrone, the left fielder. Fine prospect, college player, left-handed hitter, durable. I think his bat is a little higher end than the Mr. Hankton, but still not all that exciting to me. And if we were looking for a pitcher, our scout does recommend Chapman. He's looking for slot. We're going to just go ahead and draft him, meet his demand. And we've made our decision in the first round. Moving to the second round, still have one of the 3.5-star prospects, Eddie Bahaman, left. Might not be horrible value for a second round pick, but I'm going to spend a little time figuring out exactly which way to go. Both of the relievers, the higher end relievers, look like they're gone, but there are still several starters that we talked about at the end of the last episode. I very well may end up going back to back with the starting pitchers here. Amari Banjo, unless the changeup develops, he's really a reliever. Probably not a guy I'd grab second round. Geo Feature needs the curve to develop, which, based on my experience, is more likely than the changeup. Like the stamina and hold runner ability. Not a bad prospect. He's probably a fourth starter if he fully develops, maybe a third if everything goes well. So certainly could be a useful arm. Eddie Gunn, it's going to be borderline whether he's got three major league pitches. Do like the movement on his pitches. Doesn't throw incredibly fast. Is a left-hander. Little old for a high schooler. He's going to be turning 19 in just a couple of weeks. Dontarius Hinson. It's going to be a feast or famine guy, that's for sure. The stuff is just potentially overwhelmingly off the charts. Now, granted, he's going to need to develop the change, the curve, or the knuckle curve to be a four-pitch guy. I guess you'd throw the slider in there, too, at only 35, but he could have an absolutely incredible arsenal of pitches. The movement and the control are both potential issues. This, to me, is the type of player that I think will be a lot more interesting to potentially pick up in a few weeks in OOTP 25 once we start playing the new game. Don't know exactly how the player development lab is going to work, but I think a player like this, with just incredible stuff, potential, if you could put him into the lab in the off seasons and use, you know, one of your, it sounds like six is the default number of players you can work with, but I'm sure you can change that to whatever you think is appropriate for the league that you're playing, but use a slot on him several off seasons in a row as he's developing to maybe work on his movement and control. I think there's a chance that you could invest a lot in a pitcher like this whose stuff looks like it could be incredible and turn him into a pretty high-end starter, perhaps, in the new version of the game if you really invested in him over an extended period of time. Alan Kitchen, another guy who is also fragile, needs the change or the knuckle curve to develop to be a three-pitch guy and a starter. Stamina's fine. Not great at holding on runners. I think if I were going to go pitcher, I like Kitchen. And I also like Feature. I think I'd lean towards Feature. Always like to bring a lefty into the organization. Realize that it's kind of a different approach than I was talking about in the first round, where I went with the player in the first round who I thought was the highest ceiling. I think it's fair to say that if Kitchen developed to his full potential, he probably does have a bit higher ceiling than Feature. But I think I'm still leaning towards Mr. Feature, but going to do a little more work offline, just make sure that there's no one exceptional that I'm missing simply because he's not right at the top of the list, because our scout thinks his potential overall is a little lower than some of the other guys. And I am a little intrigued by the second baseman, Eddie Behamon, but as I noted in the last episode, you look at his glove and he's really a lot less interesting. This bat for a second baseman is very interesting, but he's not really someone that I'd want to be playing second base. He's a corner outfielder or corner infielder, and he's really not a third baseman. He's a first baseman or a corner outfielder, and at those positions, the bat certainly isn't special. It's maybe acceptable and fine if it fully develops, particularly with the fact that he's a switch hitter. But I'm definitely less interested in him. If he's somehow on the market in the third round, I'd grab him in a second. There's a couple other position players that I'm hoping will fall to the third round. But I think I'm going to go with Gio Feature. Scouting director actually recommends Alan Kitchen, which is interesting because he's the other guy that I was thinking about. Do I throw a bone to my scouting director? It's interesting. I did talk about Kitchen in the last episode because I do think his upside is really interesting. But Feature already throws harder than him. He's a lefty rather than a righty. Better stamina and holding runners. Better personality traits, although admittedly loyalty and low greed are not necessarily traits that are going to impact his development. Might end up regretting it. Kitchen maybe will become somebody that we follow his career in the minors and see if we made a mistake. But we're going to go still with Gio Feature here in the second round. Moving on to the third. Ooh, and Kitchen is still available. So those of you who are telling me I should have taken Kitchen, I might get away from your scorn by being able to pick him up. But first, we're going to see if any of the batters that I was interested in are available. And one of the batters that I was interested in is available too. So this will be an interesting decision. Go back to Kitchen. For a third round pick, even though he's fragile, the upside of him as a third rounder is pretty interesting. I don't love that he's barely throwing 90 and he's 18 and a half years old, but I still think he's got some potential. But one of the batters that I was looking at, Jesus Centeno, is still around. And he's a more interesting infield prospect to me than Behamon, honestly, because although he's not great defensively, I could see him as a starting third baseman. And he's got an interesting bat. He's durable, plus contact, plus gap power, enough speed to generate some extra base hits. Never going to strike out. Potentially acceptable home run power. Like the leadership, drawing walks is going to be an issue. he is a guy who could also definitely play either spot in the corner outfield. I feel like it definitely could be an absolute gift to us that Kitchen dropped to the third round. I don't love that he's fragile. I don't love that he doesn't throw incredibly hard. I don't love that there's no positive personality traits to ensure we maximize the chance of him reaching his potential. I don't love that he's not good at holding on runners. I think his ceiling is still very interesting, but having gone pitcher-pitcher in the first two rounds, be able to pick up a guy who's durable rather than fragile, a guy who's a good leader in the clubhouse rather than just kind of meh, a guy who can play a variety of positions. Granted, he's not a gold glove infielder anywhere. And he's not a gold glove corner outfielder. But he could be a pretty interesting utility player with a bat that looks potentially more than competent if he really reaches his potential as far as contact and avoiding strikeouts with that decent speed. Scout, for some reason, has moved off of Kitchen and onto Eddie Gunn, who we've already talked about. If we were going to ask for a batter recommendation, he would recommend Pete Otega, center fielder. He's not all that interesting to me. I'm going to go with Centino here. Those of you who like Kitchen are screaming at me right now. And not surprisingly, Kitchen is now gone. Do still have one of the three-star starters left here in the fourth round, Dontarius Hinson. As I mentioned, he's the guy who I think in OOTP 25 would be an incredibly interesting prospect to bring on. Another guy who's fragile, but throws harder. And that arsenal is very intriguing to me. And we do have excellent coaching and excellent, we have excellent coaching and we have a high level of player development spending that makes me think perhaps a guy like Hinson, we might be able to get a little lucky with. I think I might be leaning towards going back to a pitcher and taking Hinson here in the fourth round just with the potential he has, but I'll spend a little time offline investigating what the full pool looks like right now before making that decision. And our scouting director recommends Baber Kazmi, a second baseman. He does have some home run pop and is pretty good at drawing walks. He's durable. Defense, certainly not exceptional. I actually think I am going to pivot away from Hinson. As interesting a prospect as he is, I don't know that that profile works in OOTP 24. I guess he could end up being an incredible relief pitcher. But he's a guy who will potentially walk a lot of batters and give up a lot of home runs despite the devastating stuff that he might have. So I'm going to go with the center fielder, Jonathan Gibbs. To me, he's pretty good value in the fourth round. Competent defensively, some really good personality traits with a high adaptability, work ethic, and intelligence, decent speed, and a respectable batting profile. It's honestly not that much worse a batting profile than some of the outfielders who were available in the first round, quite honestly. I think he's pretty good value for a fourth rounder. Also went to Don Bosco Prep, which has generated a fair number of players in OOTP over the years. We're going to go with Gibbs here in the fourth round. Move on to the fifth. A couple interesting prospects out there among the batters. And only the reliever Juan Romero left among the three-star pitching prospects. And the scout is recommending that we go with Spitfire Romero, who does look like he could be a decent reliever, particularly if that cutter develops. If we were to go for a batter, he's back to recommending Pete Ortega, who doesn't really excite me that much. I think I'm going to go with the guy that he recommended last round, Baber Kazmi. Don't love that he may struggle to make contact, but everything else is pretty decent. He's durable. I mentioned he's not really a good defensive infielder, and with that low adaptability, it's going to take him some time to turn into a utility man. He's really kind of a DH slash first baseman who could also play second and third if you really didn't care about your defense at all. But in the fifth round, a guy who's got a good personality with a high work ethic and has got 60 home run power, 70 potential plate discipline, and is also durable, is a guy I'm willing to take a flyer on. So we will bring Mr. Kazmi in as our fifth round pick if we do anything else interesting the rest of the way in the draft. I'll be sure to let you know. And in the sixth round, the big 6'8 reliever Juan Romero that we were recommended to pick last round is still around. He's only looking for slot, so pretty good value. He'll just automatically sign here in the sixth round. I think we're going to go with him. And we're getting close to July 1st when we're going to do our full midseason review. One guy we won't be talking about is Josh Porter. I'm going to be out for about a week with an intercostal strain, but we're going to put him on the IL just to be careful, and that'll also let us bring up Juan Toledo and give him some major league action for another week and a half or so. Porter, though, having an excellent year. 304 average, 26 doubles, 12 homers, and 57 ribbies, along with 68 runs scored here on June 30th. A brilliant 157 WRC+. 15 out of 16 on the base paths. Everything that Porter could be doing to try to keep his job against the incredible pool of great, young, inexpensive outfielders we have, he is doing to try to make sure that we don't look to move on from him in the coming month, like we'll probably be moving on from his outfield mate, Mr. Boston. And another guy that we won't be talking about when we do our midseason review is Chris Lott, who's been a really good starter for us for the past few years. But he still has options left, and we just sent him down to AAA. He hasn't been great this year. The 4.31 ERA he's put up over 56 and a third innings is the worst of his major league career. As I mentioned, he still had options, and Palencia does not. And he was kind of, at this point, the weakest pitcher on our team. So we've got incredible pitching depth at this point. Certainly would hope that we'll see Lott again this year. And not that we're hoping for injuries, but he's definitely worthy of being on a major league roster. We are just very loaded at the current moment, which I'm not complaining about. And we finally made it to July 1st, and the monster season for the Buffalo Wings continues. A winning percentage of over 700, 58 and 24 is the best record in all of baseball. and we are 9.5 games up on the Marlins in the NL East, and we are 9.5 games up on the Marlins, the Reds, and the Diamondbacks for the best record in baseball. So certainly right now looking like there's a very good chance that we will have home field advantage for throughout the playoffs as we try to defend our title. Taking a look at the leaderboard, the brilliant rookie Arturo Casares leading the National League in runs batted in. Recently injured Josh Porter, second in the National League in batter war. Turning to our pitchers, the rookie Danny Black with 9 wins is tied for the league lead. So right now we are on pace to have a rookie lead the league in wins and lead the league in runs batted in, which is pretty good when you are bringing that type of talent on to your major league team. Taking a look at the team statistics, and the 58-24 record we've put up is actually one game below expectations given how well we've played. Just completed a 22-6 month of June, which was our best record of the season as far as a month, and a winning percentage of almost .800. Continue to have just an absolutely awesome offense, first in the National League in runs scored. You can see we are first in most offensive categories. The worst we rank is tied for 5th in homers. And the pitching is excellent as well. We rank 2nd in the NL in runs allowed, 82 games through the season. And you can see we are in the top 3 in every pitching category except for home runs allowed, where we're 4th, strikeouts, where we're 5th. Good running team, 4th in steals and 5th in base running, and a very good defensive team, 2nd in defensive efficiency, 1st in zone rating. So everything is going swimmingly for the Buffalo Wings here on July 1st. If we remain healthy, you know, we're on pace to win 115 or so games, which would be an outstanding season, hopefully set us up well for a long run through the playoffs. We're going to take a look at the team now and see if we can identify any holes that we might want to try to fill with the over $7 million that we've still got to spend. Continue selling out every game. So we're going to increase prices just a bit again on the good fans of Buffalo. We've got money to take on a player or two. I just don't know how many holes this team realistically has, but we're going to try to find some. One I can certainly think of is hitting at catcher, which is, interestingly, something we filled at the trade deadline a year ago when we brought on Mr. Ortega. Taking a look at players who are on the trading block right now. Don't know why I would care about, I'm still looking at other stuff, batting stats for pitchers. Some interesting pitchers out there. Our old buddy Ali Ostendorf, Gil Halbruder. I don't know that I've seen him before. 27-year-old, playing in the American League with the Astros. Played with Toronto before that, but a pretty good-looking pitcher there. So there's definitely some talent on the market at this point. Looking at the batters, incredibly huge trade blocks at this point, and actually there's got to be something wrong here. What filter do I have on right now? Players who were picked in the first round from a previous search I had done. I was wondering why there were so few players on the trade block, and that explains why. So many more people on the trade block now. Our old buddy Arturo Flores is a couple of catchers among the higher-rated players. Joe Mifsud, good defensively, not the greatest bat. We kind of already have that. David Arruza, good defensively, not the greatest bat. Kind of already have that. So I don't know if there's an obvious fix there for us. Pitchers, we're probably not going to be looking for much. But there are guys who could help us. Left-handed arm is the one thing that I think we could really look for. a guy that we moved on from years ago at this point, Ben Borgian, still out there. I don't think he's a difference maker. If I remember correctly, he's got pretty even ratings between against lefties and righties. Yeah, they're perfectly even. So that was part of the reason why we ended up moving on from him, kind of wanted more of a lefty specialist. But he could probably help us. Our old buddy Sincere Shazier on the market. Another lefty who's out there, a reliever, Ernesto Tejedo. But he's out for 2 to 3 months with shoulder inflammation. So doubtful that he will be someone that we pursue vigorously. But again, we haven't even done the midseason review yet. I don't think we have a ton of holes to try to fill. But we'll take a look, talk through the players, and open it up for discussion from our worldwide scouting network. So as we think about these Buffalo Wings here on July 1st with the number one offense in the National League and the number two pitching staff in the National League as far as runs allowed, technically pitching is our weakness. So we'll try to be objective about whether there's areas that we can improve. Jim Lance has dealt with injury issues since the first start of the season. Missed over a month and a half, but seems to be rounding into form. 3-1 record with 50 strikeouts and 40 2/3 innings. Not going to be a Cy Young Award contender like he was a year ago with a good chunk of the season missed, but think that he will end up performing well as he always does. Harlan Campeau also missed some time on the IL, but he's bounced back nicely and has proven to be a solid number two starter for us. The lack of innings pitched is a little misleading because we did have him on a pitch count for a couple of starts when he first got back, and he also was injured very early in his second start, or his first start of the season. But 5-1 record, kind of a five-inning pitcher at this point with that 45 stamina, 3.04 ERA. Not dominant, but still good. Alexis Barajas, former ace, 7-4 record with a 3.47 ERA, 1.3 WAR on the season, with Deshaun Seifu gone and retired this past off season. Alexis Barajas is the only active player who was a member of all five of our World Series championship teams and has a chance to surpass Seifu if he wins one this year. Danny Black, we've talked about a lot, former first-round draft pick 5 years ago, number 10 prospect in baseball, 9-2 record with a 2.86 ERA, would probably be a overwhelming favorite to win Rookie of the Year any year except this year when his teammate Casares may run away with the award. And then Jim Coles, another former first-round pick, the 25-year-old with the captain personality, is our fifth starter, 8-2 with a 2.80 ERA, over 90 innings pitched. You get that type of performance from a number five starter, and you're going to be feeling pretty good about things. Before we go to the relievers, just one more note. June's pitcher of the month was the veteran Barajas. He was 4-1 with a 1.46 ERA over the month of June. So the veteran is definitely really rounding into form. New closer, Chris McClintic. We picked him up at the trade deadline last year. And then we moved on from our longtime closer, Joe Scott, gave the job to McClintic this year. 4-3 with 16 saves, 2.56 ERA. Honestly, hasn't been as dominant as we perhaps would expect given the incredible stuff that he has, but still has been effective, like the fact that he is a durable pitcher. Speaking of durable pitchers, Floyd Auclair, only normal as far as his injury proneness, but very durable in terms of going out there and being a high-end stopper for us. Has led the league in games and holds for 3 consecutive years, and he's on pace to give us another 140 or so innings this year. Going to be knocking on the door of 200 strikeouts. This is a guy who, out of the bullpen, has averaged over 200 strikeouts a year for us. Brilliant 1.64 ERA this year, 2.6 WAR already. So he's on pace for about a 5 WAR season. Felt like last year he may have been gypped a bit in the voting as far as not getting a second consecutive Mariano Rivera Award. Would hope that maybe he's on pace to get that second Mariano Rivera Award this season. Simeone Minnelli, former starter for us, moved into the bullpen this year. He's been solid, 3.68 ERA, but pitching much fewer innings than he used to out of the rotation. Has given up 5 home runs in 29 and a third innings. Solano Toselli, the left-hander, finally gets to make his major league debut this year, and he's making the most of it with a 2.43 ERA over 40 and two-thirds innings. Important lefty out of our bullpen. Speaking of important lefties, the youngster Danny Kashuk, who we traded for right before the season started, only pitched in 7 games so far, but hasn't allowed a run over 9 2/3 innings and has a whip below a half. So he's an important part of our bullpen now with his left-handed arm. R.E. Caper has been a brilliant former fourth-round pick. 0.98 ERA over 27 and two-thirds innings. The problems are kind of our long relievers. Kevin Hale, the left-hander, hasn't been good this year. 6.03 ERA over 37 and third innings. He's given up 6 homers. He's pitched below replacement level. Because he's that third left-handed arm for us, we're giving him a long leash. But performance-wise, if we could do something with him, we would. But he's out of arbitration, or he's out of we're out of options on Kevin Hale, so we can't send him down. And then last but not least, Luis Palencia, who I mentioned we just brought up after we stashed him in AAA when he came back from his injury. He started 5 games there. He's been okay, small sample size in Buffalo, just 8 2/3 innings over 11 games. I mentioned Chris Lott, former starter, who ended up getting shipped off to AAA to make room for him. Joey Bills, also in AAA right now, a guy who's certainly capable of being a major league starter. Another young pitcher who's really good. So although this is technically our weakness, like I said, having guys like Lott and Bills in AAA makes me feel like we've got plenty of depth, especially when we're likely to only be going with 12 pitchers in the postseason. The one thing I might like to do is kind of upgrade that third lefty out of the pen. Real pleased with what Toselli and Kashuk are doing for us in their first years in Buffalo. But feel like Kevin Hale is a guy we could upgrade. We do like him because he does have those ratings where he's much more effective against lefties than he is against righties. But his performance on the field has not been exceptional this year. I guess we could perhaps try to move him just into a pure specialist role and have him be long reliever as his second task. Might cut down on the innings he's pitching a bit, and might give an opportunity to be a bit more effective on the mound. So if there's a great lefty out there, maybe we go after that. Other than that, I think we're just being gluttonous if we add some pitching. Doesn't mean I won't do it if there's a great opportunity out there to improve the team, since we are all in on trying to pursue a repeat, but or a three-peat, more accurately. But hopefully there will be something more interesting to do with the offense, because I don't feel like we need to invest a ton into improving this pitching staff. And turning to the offense, which has scored more runs than any team in the NL this year, I mentioned that a bat at catcher is something that we might need. Other than that, I can't think of much we're going to really want to go after. Alejandro Medina, who we picked up in the Rule 5 draft, the batting average down to 209 and 67 at-bats. Still kind of like him as someone that we want to try to keep in the organization. I think he'd be a great backup, which is what he's doing this year. Still think he can get a little better in terms of his home run power and his eye. But he has been below replacement level this year. And our starter is Juan Ramirez, who has only been a little above replacement level. We love his excellent defense, but he's also similarly struggling to hit 200, 201 average on the year. He has drawn 36 walks, so the on-base percentage is above 300, 114 points higher than his batting average. He's durable. Clearly, we've got an excellent pitching staff that's one of the top pitching staffs in baseball because we've got a lot of quality in our rotation and our bullpen, but certainly having an excellent defensive catcher like Ramirez also helps them. So I don't feel like this is a huge problem since they're both good defensive catchers, and although their batting averages are struggling to stay above 200, the defense they bring and the help they give our pitching staff makes me think that we'd be fine sticking with the catchers. If we can upgrade them, I will. But again, I'm really looking for someone who's got a bit of a bat and is a decent defensive catcher or better. A great bat who's poor defensively at catcher, I don't think does a ton for us since we're already first in the league in runs scored, even with Ramirez and Medina playing all of our games at catcher. Turning to the infield, we certainly don't need to upgrade at first base. Jim Reichert on pace to have an excellent first full season in the majors, hitting 286, 22 homers, 61 ribbies, a 144 WRC plus, and a 2.1 WAR already. Hopefully he can remain healthy the rest of the season and make a run at becoming the fourth player in Buffalo Wings history with 40-plus home runs in a season. Ramiro Medina, our second baseman, having a bit of an off year for him, hitting 247, but he does have 12 doubles, 10 homers, and 15 steals. Been a league average offensive player, still put up a 2 WAR this year. He's a pretty solid defensive second baseman with some speed. I don't think that it's going to be easy to find a player who would be a clear upgrade to Mr. Medina. Danny Ferguson at third base, having a bit of a down year compared to last year. Although, if you remember, Ferguson last year was not great in the first half of the year, and then he was excellent in the second half of the year. I don't know if there are first and second half type players in OOTP, but I'm willing to give Ferguson a little more time. The third baseman hitting 221, 10 doubles, 8 homers, 96 WRC plus, so he's been a bit below average offensively, still almost a win above replacement. Very good defensive third baseman. And with that turn double play rating, he's definitely played second base for us at times in the past. But right now, with Medina having better infield range, kind of preferring him at second, even though his turn two rating is not as good. And Medina also has a slightly weaker arm than Ferguson. So I could go back and forth with which guy to play at each position. But right now, I kind of like the way we're set up there. Damani Essien, healthy this year, which is great. Very good defensive shortstop, and he's hitting 300 for us, 103 WRC plus, 1.6 WAR on the season. I don't think any of these guys, Medina, Ferguson, and Essien, are having perfect years. I also don't think it's necessarily going to be very easy to find someone who's an upgrade at those positions, who's also available and attainable to us. So the question kind of becomes, do we need to upgrade our utility infielders? Juan Palomo, the rookie, hitting 278 in 126 at-bats, 116 WRC plus, is higher than any of the starting infielders except for Ryker at first base. He's versatile. He's good defensively. He's put up a one war, even though he's only started 33 games. Real happy with what he's done. And then Mike Whitehead has been a starting shortstop for us for much of the past several seasons. He's really become the pure utility guy this year, but he's hitting 364 in the 44 at-bats that he does have for us, 147 WRC+, a guy who's good in the clubhouse, a guy who's also solid defensively, probably the weakest of our second baseman shortstops and third baseman defensively, but he's also a pure utility guy. So to me, there's not an obvious upgrade to make among the infielders, and I really don't think there's going to be one among the outfielders either. Tim Boston is a guy we're considering trading away this month simply because we've got so much talent in outfield coming up in our farm system. He's hit 256, less power than normal, with only five homers and 234 at-bats, 89 WRC+, and he's been well below replacement level given that he's also not a great defensive outfielder. This is a guy, though, that has had a couple of pretty nice years for us his first two seasons in Buffalo with 138 and 114 WRC pluses. But with the amount of talent we have on the roster and at AAA in the outfield, I think we probably look to trade Boston so we can keep Juan Toledo on the team permanently once Mr. Porter is back from that injury. Arturo Casares, we mentioned the rookie having an outstanding season, 267 average, but 22 homers, tied for the team lead with Ryker, another guy who could get join that rare 40-plus home run club for the Buffalo Wings. Lead in the league with 68 ribbies, has put up a 129 WRC plus on the season and a 3.7 war already. Primarily playing in left field, but we are playing him as our center fielder against left-handed pitching to continue at least putting a little pressure on Ishmael Velasco there as far as his grasp on the starting center field spot. But Velasco is doing what Velasco always does, putting up a really good year. Probably one of the best seasons of his career, 306 average, 24 doubles and 11 homers here at the midway point of the season. He's also stolen 11 bases, so a 143 WRC plus, a 3.5 war. He, of course, for those of you who have watched, is also a fan favorite, durable, and he has been the World Series most valuable player in each of our last three World Series championships that he's been a part of. So Velasco doing his job as well. Jamari Habersham is a guy similar to Boston. Maybe we look to move on from him, but they're both left-handed hitters, so probably wouldn't move on from both of them. Habersham hitting 286 in 161 at-bats. He's also 5 out of 6 stealing bases. Below average offensively and basically just a replacement-level player this year. He does bring a dimension with speed that Boston doesn't have. He's a better defensive outfielder than Boston, and he's a better contact hitter than Boston, even though he doesn't have that same type of power, and he is inept as far as being able to draw walks. But I think that I would be inclined to probably keep Habersham over Boston. I guess the only way that I might not would be at the end of the last episode, we looked at Boston's trade market, and it wasn't overwhelming what we could get back in return for him. If there was massively better demand for Habersham, maybe we trade him instead of Boston. And then Juan Toledo, who spent most of the year in Albany, where he's hit a ridiculous 322 with a even more ridiculous 30 home runs and 242 at-bats. Back up in the majors now, 308 with a homer in 26 at-bats for us, and he should get some run over the next week and a half until Mr. Porter is ready to come off of the IL. And actually, we haven't even played a game since we've done that. So we'll play our first game today without Mr. Porter and with Toledo in the lineup. So as I think about this lineup, Hall of Fame catcher with a great glove and a great bat. Yeah, I'd love to add that. The infield, I don't know how we're going to get better. And honestly, if we trade away Boston or Habersham, that just opens up the spot for Josh Porter to come back off the IL. If we traded away both Boston and Habersham, that lets us put Porter back onto the team. And then we likely promote Daniel Aguayo Leal from Albany, because all he's done down there is hit 301 with 27 homers and 286 at-bats. I kind of am hoping, as much as Aguayo Leal can help us, and he could end up being on the playoff roster this year, but I'm almost kind of hoping to not have him make his major league debut till next year, just so he'll be on a little bit of a different pace than Toledo and Casares, who are both playing their first seasons this year. Now, granted, we have signed Casares to an extension already, so he's not going to be kind of progressing the same way as Toledo through minimum salary contracts and then arbitration years. But I don't see any real need to rush Aguayo Leal to the majors. That said, if we did trade away both Boston and Velasco, or not Velasco, Boston and Habersham, replacing them with Porter and Aguayo Leal and keeping Toledo up, arguably, and maybe even not arguably, makes us a better offensive team. I guess we could look for someone better than Whitehead as a utility infielder, but team veteran that is respected in the clubhouse, can play second, third, and short competently. And despite a batting profile that probably translates is a bit below average, hasn't been that far below average over the course of his career with a 90 WRC plus, with his glove, with his efficiency on the base paths, he's been a positive WAR player for us every year, even though, as I noted, he's getting much less playing time this season than he has in the past. So I don't see any glaring holes. A super left-handed reliever, a superstar catcher would be the two dream things for us to add. As I noted when I looked at the trade block, there's not really either of those things available on the trade market right now. Maybe before I finish off, I'll just take a look at whether those players actually even exist in baseball right now. I mean, I looked for a lefty with 60 stuff, 55 movement, and 55 control. So someone who's kind of above average in everything. And there's only six of those guys in the game. We've got one of them with the youngster, Kashuk. Jesus Fierro from the Braves, and he is very unhappy with his performance, which hasn't been horrible. 3.78 ERA as a starter. The price tag for him is going to be high as a starter. He'd certainly be a great addition to the team. And if we did have a lefty in the rotation, that would make maybe having only two lefties in the pen a little more palatable. He wants to be a closer. No, he wants to be in the starting rotation. They're using him as a closer, I guess, just all of a sudden, because he started 15 games out of his 16 appearances, but he does have one save, and he pitched 11 just pitches 3 days ago, which presumably was that one relief appearance and one save. I don't know why you would have a pitcher like this in the bullpen. I'm assuming that the demands for him are going to be incredible. Actually, there's guys I would consider trading for him. Steve Fitch is a guy we picked in the second round back in 2043, but he doesn't hasn't impressed with his development thus far or his performance on the mound. He does have that captain personality, but I mean, Fierro's making a lot of money in the subsequent years, but the price for him for a win now team is not overwhelming. Do we try to add a lefty into the rotation? I mean, I'm just surprised the price for him is so low. That's interesting. Definitely something to think about there. Going back to the player list, Nehemiah Vidale, a brilliant left-handed starter for the Guardians, only 5-7 this year. I can't imagine the price for him is going to be anything reasonable. We've got no one who makes the deal work, but that could also just be because he's making so much money. But yeah, we'd have to give up a Casares or a Riker for him, which is not shocking. He looks like an incredible pitcher. Santiago Rosario of the Twins. He's more of a pure reliever. He was claimed on waivers from Baltimore on New Year's Eve last year. He hasn't been great. Similar profile against lefties as he has against righties. He'd certainly likely be pretty cheap to obtain. Eli Buckles is injured, out with a torn rotator cuff. Not really the answer we're looking for there. And then Brad White, another starter, first round pick in 2042. I would have to imagine the Nationals are going to be looking for a lot for him as a 25-year-old. Heading into arbitration next year. Don't like some of the personality traits, but I would think that his price is going to be, yeah, we got nobody that makes the deal work with him because he's cost-effective. Rosario, I'm guessing, is going to be certainly more obtainable. Well, they want a good player back in return, and I don't blame them for that. So it's strange, but it looks to me like the left-handed starter, Jesus Fierro, the 27-year-old, who does have a long-term contract that would be difficult for us to keep on board with the extensions that we've given to, well, the extension we gave to Lance and the fact that we've now signed Reichert and Casares both to extensions, but we do have a little flexibility next year with the fact that we've got the team option on Harlan Campo, and he's older. The price for Fierro just seems incredibly low to me. I don't know how much of his contract we'd be able to get them to retain, which would help us a little bit. I'm guessing not much at all. And I don't know, there may be other relievers other than, or other minor league starters other than Fitch that I'd be willing to throw in here. But just going to, they'll only keep 5% of the contract with Fitch. So we would be taking on a significant amount of money. But, I mean, Fierro's been an above average lefty over the course of his career, has never had an ERA in the majors higher than the 3.93 that he's put up this year. Still has good ratings, a four-pitch arsenal, plus stamina, really good at holding on runners, throws in the high 90s. Scouting report, you know, in terms of where we think his potential is, has gone a little bit down these past this past year, year and a half. We think the movement on his pitches isn't as good as it once was. But he is certainly a very tempting potential addition at this point. You're going to kind of have to talk me out of making a play for him. Again, we don't really need help, but if we're going to do anything with the pitching staff, it's going to be to bring on another lefty. We're going to keep Coles in the rotation because he's the only captain personality we have on the team right now, which means that the rookie Danny Black, who is leading the National League in wins, tied for the National League lead in wins, to be fair, would likely get moved to the bullpen if we did make this trade to bring on the lefty. But with an established lefty in the rotation, as I said, I'd feel a little more comfortable maybe only going with Toselli and Kashuk as two lefties out of the pen and potentially moving on from Kevin Hale. If the price wasn't so darn cheap, and not that it's totally cheap, we're giving up a good pitching prospect, but not a top of the rotation pitching prospect, at least with the way he looks right now, even though we did use a premium pick on him. If you don't think I should do this, you're going to have to make a very eloquent argument in the comments to this episode. Doesn't look like we're going to have a ton of options at catcher. We're looking for someone who's still above average defensively, who's at least competent in contact, power, and eye, all being at league average. And the only guy who meets that profile is the guy who we traded for and rented a year ago, Luis Ortega. Weren't able to bring him back with the crazy money that he's making. And he's got a big contract for the next few years. Plus, Philadelphia just re-signed him. You know, they traded us to him. They traded him to us last offseason when he was just a rental, and then they brought him back. I don't think there's any realistic way for us to pick up Ortega with the amount of money he's making this year and the amount of money that he's on the books for in subsequent seasons. So we may have to lower our standards just a bit. And when we up the defense a bit, since we're going to weaken the offense and are just looking for guys who are, you know, borderline respectable contact, power, and eye, our current starter Juan Ramirez is on the list. The other options are Luis Alvarado. I don't think that bat gets us much that we don't already have with Ramirez. Josh Bookout from the Marlins. I like the glove, I like the durability, but he's making $12 million and don't see where he's going to be markedly better than Ramirez with the bat. He's hitting .215 this year, so he's 14 points higher or so. I think Ramirez was hitting .201. Yeah, so it's not nothing, but it's not a game-changing difference. Alvarado is hitting .246 this year, but he hit .216 a year ago. And then Joe Beard of the Giants. Again, really good defensive ability, like the captain personality. But he's a .218 hitter, and he's fragile physically, and he's making $21 million a year. So I don't know that there's a lever for us to push on the catchers that's going to be materially better than what we have with Juan Ramirez at this point. So it may end up being that somehow our big move is to go for a left-handed starting pitcher, even though at this point with Bills and Lott in the minors and Minnelli and Palencia and Caper and even Toselli to some extent in our bullpen, we've got about 10 major league quality starting pitchers either on our major league pitching staff are in AAA right now, and we might still look to add another. So it could be an embarrassment of riches here for the Buffalo Wings. I'll give it some thought. If you've got thoughts on what we should do, would love to hear them. As always. But to me, the opportunity to add Jesus Fierro is pretty darn interesting. And with that, I will finally call it an episode. Best team in baseball. Best offense in the National League. Second best pitching staff in the National League. Got a rookie leading the league in ribbies. Got a rookie leading the league in wins. And we're not happy. We're looking for more. Because anything less than a three-peat is going to be a big disappointment. And we'll find out what type of progress we make in the trade market in our next episode. Until then, thanks so much for watching, and hope you have a great day.